Okay, last week we, you recall that when David's successor, his son King Solomon, when he was old, that his many foreign wives, they turned his heart after other gods. And he went after these gods, and he built altars for the worship of these gods at the urging of his wives. And then in 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 9 through 13, God tells Solomon that during the reign of Solomon's son, he's going to divide the kingdom. It is because of how Solomon has treated him that in the reign of Solomon's son, he's going to divide the kingdom, and he's going to give 10 tribes to one of Solomon's servants, and he's going to give two tribes. He's going to leave the two tribes under the control of Solomon's son. Well, the servant to whom God said in verse 11 that he was going to give the kingdom, that servant is Jeroboam. And he's an Ephraimite. And Solomon, he was Solomon's servant, and that Solomon had put him in charge of his forced labor, his conscripted laborers. That's one of the things that kings did. When they became king, they got your labor. It was like a draft. And so he was in charge of the forced labor. And when Jeroboam was in his capacity as Solomon's servant, he was out away from Jerusalem, and the prophet Ahijah told him that God was going to make him king over Israel, that he was going to give him the 10 northern tribes that he was going to take from Solomon's son. And for that reason, as I said at the end of the class last week, Solomon tries to kill Jeroboam because he knows of this. Word gets back to Solomon. He tries to kill Jeroboam. And Jeroboam, then he flees to Egypt for safety. Solomon's death is reported in 1 Kings chapter 11. He died around 931, or some would put it at 930 BC, and he died having reigned for 40 years. And then Solomon's 41-year-old son, Solomon dies, and then his 41-year-old son, Rehoboam, he assumes the throne after Solomon's death. And it's perhaps indicative of the existing disaffection of the northern tribes that when Rehoboam goes to be proclaimed or formally installed as king, he goes to Shechem to do that instead of Jerusalem. Okay, instead he goes up here into the northern part up there. And so that suggests at least that there's already this disaffection. We've seen this before. There's been this tension. But he goes to Shechem for his formal appointment as king. And then after Rehoboam, after he becomes king, is formally installed, Jeroboam then comes back. So he fled to Egypt when Solomon's trying to kill him. When after Rehoboam is installed, he comes back, and with representatives of all the northern tribes, he offers Rehoboam a deal. He comes in, he says, listen, with all the representatives, all representing Israel, he comes and he says, listen, if you will ease up on the burdens that your father Solomon had imposed on us in terms of forced labor, then we'll serve you. And that's how we'll do it. If you'll just lighten up on the burden that he had imposed on us. And well, the old men, they advise Rehoboam, that's a good thing. You go ahead and do that, and you show them that, and then they'll serve you faithfully, and that'll be good. But Rehoboam listens to the advice of his young peers, the young bucks. You see, he listens to them, and they basically, they tell him no. You know, their advice was in essence, listen, you tell Jeroboam to drop dead. That's pretty much what it is. So he told the Israelites, 3 days after they made their offering, he tells them in 12:14, my father made your yoke heavy, but I'll add to your yoke. My father disciplined you with whips, but I'll discipline you with scorpions. So that was the answer. You know, so Jeroboam says, listen, if you lighten up, and he says, lighten up, what are you, crazy? I'm going to make things worse, heavier. I'm bigger, badder, tougher, and I'm going to do that. Well, as we used to say, that went over like a lead balloon. Okay, so the northern tribes, they split from the tribe of Judah, and here you see, we have the northern tribes of Israel, the southern tribe, or the southern nation of Israel, and you have the southern nation of Judah. And you see in 1 Kings 12:15, it says, so the king did not listen to the people, for it was a turn of affairs brought about by the Lord that he might fulfill his word, which the Lord spoke by Ahijah the Shilonite to Jeroboam son of Nebat. So you remember when he told Jeroboam, the prophet said, you're going to become king, he's going to give you this. All right, well, that's what this is. This is playing out. So we then have this split here. And from chapter 12, verse 17, and chapter 12, verse 20, it seems like Benjamin, the tribe of Benjamin, was briefly with the northern tribes. But when you look in chapter 12, verse 21, it indicates that they quickly came to align with Judah. And that's what you have, Judah and Benjamin in the south. And then you have the 10 tribes in the north. The 10 northern tribes, they were known generally as Israel. But sometimes you got to be careful because that term will be thrown around. They're known generally as Israel, and the two southern tribes are known generally as Judah. Now, the split of these nations, it's solidified when Rehoboam, he decides he's going to test the seriousness of this split. Is this really something that's going to hold, or can they be persuaded? He decides he's going to test the seriousness of it by sending Adoram, who's a man in charge of his forced labor, he sends him up to Israel. Well, he gets the clue how serious it is when they stone him to death. So he goes up there, they stone him to death, which when the news comes to back to Rehoboam, he flees back to Jerusalem from wherever he is because he realizes, okay, this is serious. They're willing to kill my emissary. So he flees back to Jerusalem, and then Jeroboam's officially made king over the northern tribes, over the nation of Israel, as God had told him would happen. Well, Rehoboam, he assembles this huge army to go fight Israel. He's going to go, as you can imagine, he's going to go and attack Israel and do that kind of thing. But God told him through a prophet named Shemaiah. He tells Rehoboam, look, not to do that. He tells him in chapter 12, verse 24, that this division was ordained by him. He says, this is from me. Okay, so you're to call this off, and he does. Now, it's just interesting to me that, you know, obviously there are some events in history that are acts of God in a special way. You see, beyond his general providence and guiding of all things in the world, because he can say, this rebellion is for me. Well, you know, so it's just interesting how God's hand works. And apparently it's not always obvious. It just looked like a regular, ordinary rebellion, but he said, no, this is for me. Okay, for me in a distinctive way. Okay, and that has some implications just in other places, but it's interesting. Okay, so the Israel remains now a divided kingdom. You have the two kingdoms, Israel to the north, Judah to the south, remains that way for centuries. I only have two slides today because I didn't know how to go at kings. To say anything, I mean, you know, we've got a lot of kings. So we have 2 weeks on kings. And I can't get through them in 2 weeks. But what I could do, I think I can get far enough, and then we get to the fall of Samaria, then you can pick up some of the other kings there, which I'll not be teaching that class. Somebody else is going to be filling in. I should know who it was, but I forget. So then when we do the fall of Judah, of Jerusalem, we can pick up some of the other kings. But I'm just going to get as far as I can. Now, but Israel remains divided for centuries. And each kingdom, as you can see, had many kings that ruled one after the other. And all the kings of Judah, with the exception of this usurper, Athaliah, who's a queen, all the kings of Judah, they were all descendants of David, whereas the kings of Israel, they come from a number of different families. So there's one dynasty in Judah, as God had promised. But in Israel, you get different families, different dynasties. So one family will come, you'll have a couple of descendants, another family, another family, another family. So that's one of the general things. And some of the kings of Judah were righteous, not as many as we would like. But some of the kings of Judah were righteous, but all the kings of Israel were unfaithful to God. All of them. Some more than others, but all of them were unfaithful. They were unfaithful to God. Now, the northern kingdom continued in existence until it was conquered by the Assyrians, the final blow coming with the fall of Samaria, which was the capital of Israel, and that was in 722, some would put it at 721 BC. So they remained in existence for that time. The southern kingdom of Judah was conquered by the Babylonians, the next reigning world power after the Assyrians. They were conquered by the Babylonians. the final blow coming with the fall of Jerusalem in 587 or 586. Now, that was the third of three deportations. You had a deportation in 605, you had one in 597, you had another one in 587, 586. So you had some people taken away, some people taken away in 597, and then 587, 86, Jerusalem's destroyed and other people are taken away. So that was the southern kingdom was conquered by the Babylonians there. Now the Jews were allowed to return to Judah after the Persian Cyrus conquered the Babylonians in 539. Now this was as prophesied. In fact, God called Cyrus out by name that he was going to raise up Cyrus. And so in 539, Cyrus, he conquers the Babylonians that with conquering the city of Babylon. And we're going to have to say more about that down the road. But I wanted to give you kind of a big picture of what, you know, you have the split. Israel goes, the Assyrians take them out. Then you have Judah continuing, and then they're finally taken into captivity in 587, 586. Now, Jeroboam, after this split, Jeroboam, the king of Israel, he feared that the people are going to return to Israel if they keep going back down there and offering sacrifices at the temple. He says, this isn't going to be a good idea, though. They will eventually be swayed back to loyalty to Rehoboam. If they're coming down there and mixing and doing all this and having all this high religious time down there, that this is really the focal point, we are really here and you got to come to us for God. Well, he says, that's not going to play well for me. You see, they will eventually be swayed back to loyalty, and that will result in his execution. He knows that. You see, once the people turn, then they're going to see him as somebody who's an enemy, and he'll wind up getting killed. So he set up a golden calf in the cities of Dan and Bethel. I think I can go back. Do I have those cities up there? Yes. He sets up, see, in Dan and down in Bethel. So he puts a golden calf in each of those two cities, and he urged the people, go there for worship instead of to Jerusalem. That's what you need to be doing. And he also made temples on high places, and he appointed priests, people who were not from the tribe of Levi. He's creating an alternate religion. It's got certain, you know, affinities to the religion of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that God has given to Moses, but he's creating something different. He's got here these idols. Now, some people say, well, the way he sold them was that, you know, it was a picture of Yahweh riding on the golden calves. But they're worshiping these things. Okay, they're worshiping. So, but he's trying to keep the people and draw them up there so that they will wind up doing that. He created his own religious feast. He just creates a religious feast. God had prescribed religious feasts. You see? And when God does that, then you go by those. No, he wanted to create one of his own. See, he creates one of his own to compete with one of the religious feasts that God had prescribed that took place in Judah. And he also offered sacrifices to the calves that he'd made. Well, in 1 Kings chapter 13, a man of God from Judah, he prophesied to Jeroboam at Bethel. And he spoke against the altar, which symbolized Jeroboam's religious innovations. That's what this symbolized. He spoke against the altar. He's condemning Jeroboam's religious innovations. And he told him that a man named Josiah, I'll go back to this, a man named Josiah would be born in the house of David, and he would sacrifice the priests of pagan gods on an altar in Bethel. Josiah by name. Now, some 300 years later, this prophet's words were fulfilled. The Judean king Josiah fulfilled that prophecy, and you see it in 2 Kings chapter 23, 15 to 20. Well, when Jeroboam, you see, this is what prophets do. Prophets, true prophets, tell the truth. This guy's up here with this king, and he's saying this against the king. So the king points out and reaches out to him, stretches out his hand, and he signals that the prophet's to be arrested. And when he does that, his arm, his hand is shriveled and incapacitated. That's a clue that, you know, that something's wrong here. Seize him. This is what happens to him. Well, at the prayer of the prophet, Jeroboam's hand is restored. But Jeroboam just wouldn't be deterred from his path of idolatry. You would suspect that after this, you would hope after this prophecy that you would get some repentance. No, he wouldn't be deterred. Well, when Jeroboam's son Abijah, his son becomes ill, he sends his wife in disguise to the prophet Ahijah. You remember, Ahijah was the prophet who told him that God was going to give him the northern kingdom. So he sends his wife in disguise. You go there to this prophet and you find out what's going to happen to our son. Well, of course, it doesn't fake the prophet out, but he's told who's coming. She comes in and she says, "Hey, why are you disguised? I know who you are." So she goes to see him, and the prophet tells her that the child's going to die as soon as she returns home, which happened. And he said God was going to kill all of Jeroboam's male descendants, going to extinguish Jeroboam's lineage. There will be no more. He's going to extinguish Jeroboam's lineage because of his evil idolatry. And this too would come to pass at the hand of his successor, a man named Baasha. So he tells them that. Now, 1 Kings 14:30, it reveals that there's ongoing military conflict between Rehoboam, the king of Judah, and Jeroboam, the king of Israel. But there's no indication that either of them was really able to gain an upper hand. These may have been border skirmishes, this ongoing military activity. But if it was more serious fighting, if that's what's intended, well, then presumably the Lord allowed that more serious fighting to go forward, unlike his initial intervention. You remember when he stopped Rehoboam, who was going to attack? Well, if something more serious than border skirmishes is involved, then presumably God allowed that to go forward because Jeroboam had chosen to act in rebellion. He stops him first, but then when he's acting this way, he says, "Okay, you guys can go ahead and be at war." But you see that this was something that was going on. Then Jeroboam, son of Nebat, he becomes a byword. He becomes a symbol of the evil of the northern kingdom. He serves in Judean history as kind of a gauge of evil. He's like the standard of evil. This guy up here doing these kinds of things. Though God had told him through the prophet Ahijah before he fled to Egypt, God had told him that he would be with him and he would build him a sure house if he would be faithful to him. He told him that, but despite that, Jeroboam acted in the flesh and he did what he thought was best for securing his rule, even though it involved him in flagrant rebellion against God. You see, he thought, no, the way to do this, the way to keep my rule, I know how to do it. I have to do these things because if they start going down to the south, they'll eventually be swayed back. No, I got to do this. Instead of just saying, "I'm with you, God. You drive things, and I'll be faithful to you, and I'll trust you." No. He had to take things in his own hands, and you see what happened. Well, the moral climate under Rehoboam in the south, the moral climate under Rehoboam in Judah deteriorated beyond the idolatry of Solomon. 2 Chronicles 12:1 says that Rehoboam abandoned the law of the Lord. Solomon had drifted away. Solomon had been pulled into idolatry late in his life. Wasn't good. Now we have Rehoboam abandoning the law of the Lord. And as a result, in 2 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 5, in the fifth year of Rehoboam's reign, God allows Shishak, who is a pharaoh in Egypt, he allows Shishak to come up and to capture fortified cities in Judah. Now, this is the same Shishak to whom Jeroboam had fled when he was hiding from Solomon. But this Egyptian pharaoh comes up and captures these land. When he came up against Jerusalem, he was bought off by the treasures of the temple and the palace. Basically, they said, "Go ahead and take whatever you want." So, you know, to preserve the city. So he comes in and hauls off all of this stuff that, you know, that was there. And so that's what happens with Rehoboam. All of that's taken off, but because the king and the people, they had humbled themselves. Because they humbled themselves, God spared the city from destruction. So here we have Rehoboam who abandons the law of the Lord. God allows Shishak to come up, take these fortified cities, get all the way to Jerusalem. They go ahead and say, "Go ahead and take all the stuff." But they spare the city because they had humbled themselves. You can see this in 1 Kings 14:25 and 26, 2 Chronicles 12, 1-9. Now, there were a lot of things that I could bring in, archaeological stuff, but I'd done a series called The Bible and Archaeology, and there'd just be too many things. I can't get through the kings and do this. But there is an interesting inscription that dates from 920 that was found at the Temple of Amon in Thebes, which is modern Luxor, Egypt, and was found in 1825, which confirms this raid by Shishak. Nothing to do with the Bible. It's an Egyptian inscription. I mean, from those folks, and you see it confirms this raid here. All right, so now back in Judah, the next king that we get in Judah, so this is kind of how I'm going to do this. I'm just going to go through these and say a little bit. Okay? Just say a little bit. And I didn't know how else to do it. I just come here and say there were a lot of kings, so there you have it, end of class. Or I can try to say something about them and give you some idea of some of the things that are going on, where some things fit in the hope that that'll be of some benefit to you. Now we have in Judah, the next king we get, and some of these names, by the way, you have Abijah, it's also referred to as Abijam, or will be translated that way, rendered that way. And you see Joram is also Jehoram. That's just how these names go. And it gets complicated because sometimes you'll have a Joram slash Jehoram and a Joram slash Jehoram. One will be in Israel, one will be in Judah. And Azariah will be in Israel, one will be in Judah. Okay, so the names are something, but we have Abijam slash Abijah. He comes to the throne, and he follows in his father's footsteps, Rehoboam, which isn't a good thing. He follows in his father's footsteps, but he recognized the wrong that Israel had done in trying to establish an alternative religion. He saw that that was not something that was right. And the Lord gave Abijah a victory, a military victory over Jeroboam, against all odds. It was one of these divine deliverances. And so he gives him a military victory over Jeroboam, something from which Jeroboam never quite fully recovered. But so he was not a good king, but he at least recognized that, and God did bless him with that victory. The next king we get in Judah is Asa. And he comes to the throne in 911, probably. Sometimes there's a year off here in the chart that's here and some other things, but I think maybe 9-11, but that 1 year's close enough, right? I mean, we're really in the ballpark, and I'm sure you could debate these things. But we have here Asa. Now, he's one of the good kings. Asa's one of Judah's good kings. For example, he removed his grandmother, Maacah. He removed her from the position of queen mother because she had made an image for worshiping the goddess Asherah. So she makes this image, and he says, I don't care, you're out. All right, that's not easy to do. But so he's one of the good kings who did that, but he stumbled a bit toward the end of his life. And this is one of the things when you read this, you just see people are people, People get pressed on. There are those that stand out as just really notable, righteous people. There are other people who are really struggling and doing right, and then you see them collapse. But he was a good king. But he did stumble a bit at the end of his life. He imprisoned the prophet Hanani for rebuking him. And he entrusted his foot disease entirely to doctors. You see, and the sense I get is that he's looking to them instead of God as being the true healer. And there also may be another issue here, because at this time the medicine may have employed magic, you see, which would involve them in some kind of occultic thing. But he kind of stumbles there. But God gave him victory. He was attacked by Zerah the Ethiopian. God gives him a victory there, gives King Asa a victory. But the next year after that, he gets this victory by God, this great victory by God. And then the next year, when the Israelite king Baasha, he had come down and he had fortified Ramah, which is a city just 4 miles north of Jerusalem. And what he's doing, he fortifies this city to choke off traffic to Jerusalem. And this is his plan, and this is going to be something that's very dangerous to Jerusalem and to the southern kingdom of Judah. But this is what he's doing in fortifying that city. But despite the fact God had delivered him when he'd been attacked by Zerah the Ethiopian, we have Asa this time. He goes to Ben-Hadad, the king of Damascus, and he pays him to attack Israel. You go ahead, and they won't be able to concentrate on me. You go ahead and attack them. So the guy says, all right, if the price is right, what do I care about treaties? All right, so he pays him off. He goes and attacks And so then Baasha had to abandon that fortification project he was building at Ramah, which allowed Asa to go up and dismantle it. So you look and say, well, that was pretty wise strategy. You see, pay this guy, he attacks him, he abandons, you go up and destroy this thing that was threatening you. But the prophet says that the prophet Hanani rebuked Asa for obligating himself to a foreign power rather than depending on God. You see, and you see this temptation always, that they wind up saying, listen, I must act and I must do these things and put my confidence in military might and in these strategies rather than trusting in God. I can't trust him to really act. And say, didn't he just act over here? Isn't he the God that brought you out of Egypt? And he's done all of these things, and you have to run and say, no, I have to do this. And this is life, you see. This is how life works. I must act this way because I see this and that. Instead of being faithful to God and trusting God, letting the chips fall where they may, leaving it in his hand, I will be faithful to him. I will live in accordance with how he wants me to live and let him control what happens. But I will not take things in my own hand and abandon faithfulness to him because I see it a certain way. That is a constant temptation to mankind that transcends these kings. Okay, but you see this going on here. Now, we go to Israel. You kind of bounce back and forth. We go over to Israel. You have two kings, Nadab, you have, and then Baasha. Well, Jeroboam dies in the second year of Asa's reign, and he's succeeded by his son Nadab, who reigns only a year before he's killed by Baasha. And as soon as Baasha became king, he killed all of Jeroboam's descendants. Okay, he comes in and he kills all of Jeroboam's descendants as the prophet Ahijah had told Jeroboam's wife. And when he sent there and says, how's my kid going to turn out? And he says, well, your kid's going to die when you go back. And by the way, all of Jeroboam's descendants are going to get killed because of how he's acted, because of what he's done. Now, Baasha quickly fell into the sins of Jeroboam. Now, somewhere you're thinking, well, you know, here's God using, he comes to the throne, you think he'd be faithful and throw himself over. No, that's not how it works. Baasha falls into the sins of Jeroboam, and God, through the prophet Jehu, he pronounced against him the same judgment that he pronounced against Jeroboam. See, despite the fact that God had allowed him to come to power, all of his descendants would be killed. His lineage would be extinguished. You see, so this is the thing. What you see happening, you see, is God takes out dynasties in the north. When they rebel against him, he kills them all. You're going to be extinguished. Your line is going to be cut off. There will be no dynasty for you out. But he doesn't do that in the south. And we've got some wicked kings in the south. And why doesn't he do it in the south? Because he made a commitment to David. He made a commitment to David. And he says, I won't do that. I will discipline you, and I'll take them into captivity and all that kind of thing, but I will not cut out the dynasty from you as I did with Saul and as he's doing with these kings in the north. So we have that. And then next in Israel, we get Baasha's son, Elah. He reigns a couple of years before he's assassinated by a military man named Zimri. And so you see, this is difficult politics. You see, this is a rough world. But he goes there and he's assassinated by a man named Zimri, a military person. And Zimri then immediately destroyed the house of Baasha as had been prophesied. He comes in and destroys Baasha's house, but he only reigns 7 days before a sizable portion of the population, the people, they made Omri, the commander of the army, they made him king over Israel. So you see these things, not only do you get here, you got to secure this. You got to really establish yourself as king. He comes as king, but the people say, no, we're going to go with Omri. Well, that doesn't turn out good for you. You see, when they say we're going to go with another king. Now, the army promptly attacked Tirzah, the city where Zimri's located, and then Zimri winds up burning the house down around him when the handwriting was on the wall that he was going to be caught and killed. So he just burned down the house around him. This is what happens to him. Now, Omri comes to the throne in the north. Omri comes to the throne in 885, and after Omri's supporters, they still weren't finished. They had to go kill a rival named Tibni, because we had somebody else out here who was threatening that, you know, yeah, no, I got a gathering, I got people. All right, well, not anymore, because we're going to kill you. And this is what happened. So he gets killed, and then Omri's established as the undisputed ruler, and he founds the city of Samaria, which became the capital of Israel. He goes and founds that city, becomes the capital of Israel. That's the city that will then ultimately be sacked by the Assyrians in 722, 721. But the next three kings of Israel, Ahab, Ahaziah, and Joram / Jehoram, the next three kings there, they're all descendants of Omri. So Omri's house, his family line, he had a dynasty that went from 885 to 841. And there are Assyrian documents that have been recovered. Assyrian documents from a century after King Omri ruled that still referred to Israel as the house of Omri. That's how the Assyrians referred to Israel. And it's because of this, because of Omri, and then because of his descendants. Omri did evil in the Lord's eyes and walked in the ways of Jeroboam. We go, the next king, Ahab in Israel. Ahab was a wicked king, very wicked, who probably for political reasons, he married Jezebel, who's the daughter of the Philistine Ethbaal. And when you got Baal on the end of your name, that doesn't sound, Ethbaal. Okay, B-A-A-L. When you've got that on the end of your name, it's not good. I guess you could make it good. You could transcend your name. But he marries the daughter of this Philistine, Ethbaal, who's the king of the Sidonians. And Jezebel was bent on substituting Baal for Yahweh within Israel. That seemed to be her career goal, was I'm going to turn Israel into worshiping Baal instead of worshiping Yahweh, such as their worship of Yahweh was. But she's interested in that. Now, she's the one who had Naboth murdered. Remember, so Ahab wants the vineyard, and Naboth says, oh, I can't sell it, man. It's family stuff. And she said, what are you doing? Just have this chump killed. And she did. And he got the vineyard. But she's the one. So it gives you an idea of the kind of person you're talking about here. Now, it's during Ahab's reign that the famous confrontation on Mount Carmel took place between the prophet Elijah and the prophets of Baal. You see that in 1 Kings 18. 1 Kings 21, Elijah, he prophesied to Ahab that his house would be like the house of Jeroboam and Baasha. Well, that's not good. You see, he says that your house is going to be like that, meaning his descendants would be killed, and he said that dogs would eat Jezebel in Jezreel. Well, you know, when a prophet tells you this, this is not good. But you see, people, the word of God doesn't always have the effect, you see, that you would hope. You say to people, you would expect they'd go, ooh, and seek God. Some people just puff up and say, basically, your mama. You know, that's my phrase. But just means I'm going to, you know, forget you. I'm going to do what I want to do. And so you wind up seeing that. Now, Ahab was killed when in an alliance with the Judean king Jehoshaphat, he was trying to take the city of Ramah. He's trying to take the city Ramoth-Gilead. He's trying to take Ramoth-Gilead from the Syrians. And if I can get this thing to go back, if I can turn it around right. And Ramoth-Gilead is going to be right up around in here somewhere. Right up around somewhere. That's going to be close. But he wants to go up there and take that city from the Syrians. So he dies when he's trying to do that, and he's in an alliance with Jehoshaphat. Now, the prophet Micaiah, son of Imlah, had told him that would happen. You may remember this story. See, he told him that was going to happen. The other prophet's saying, now go, you're going to have great success. And Micaiah comes in, it's not going to happen. You're going to be killed. Well, Ahab, of course, threw him in prison. You see, this is how power sometimes reacts to the truth. It comes after it. Well, Jehoshaphat becomes king in Judah. He becomes king 873. And he was a good king, walking in the steps of his father Asa. He sent teachers and Levites throughout the cities of Judah to teach the way of God and to administer justice. However, he entered into a marriage alliance. He had his son marry the daughter, you see, of Israel's wicked king Ahab and Jezebel. So that's not good. But that's what he enters into, this marriage alliance. And he also joined Ahab in this ill-fated attempt that I just mentioned to take Ramoth-Gilead from the Syrians. Well, Jehu, who's the son of the prophet Hanani, he rebuked him saying, "Should you help the wicked and those who hate the Lord?" See, because of this alliance with these kings, this Ahab, this guy's, an absolute apostate God hater. No, it's so cool. We're going to do it. It's just kind of politics. We don't want to get in the way of politics. That's what we're talking here. Well, he's rebuked for that. He says, why would you enter into that? Why would you enter into such an alliance as that? Well, he later joins Ahaziah, the king of Israel, one of Ahab's sons. He later joins him in a shipbuilding project at the Gulf of Aqaba. But the prophet Elijah, he's a good king. But you see these things here. He enters into that alliance. He enters into the marriage alliance. He enters into this attack on Ramoth-Gilead in alliance with Ahab. He enters into a shipbuilding project with Ahab's son Ahaziah. But as the prophet Eleazar had told him, nothing's going to come of this. And as the prophet had told him, the Lord destroyed those ships before the project ever took off. So he's into this. He said, nope, just going to become nothing. So, but it's kind of gentle the way the Lord is dealing with him. He says, no. And that winds up getting knocked off the board. He also aligned himself with Joram/Jehoram, king of Israel, Ahab's second son. And he goes with him and the king of Edom when they attack Moab, to bring Moab back into subjection so Moab would again pay tribute to Israel. And they have a fierce battle, and King Mesha of Moab rebounded in time to save Moab from complete destruction. And there is an artifact of this. It's called the Mesha Stone, where you get this from the side of the Moabites. And I've looked at that when we did the Bible and archaeology, and somewhere down the road I'm going to do the Bible and archaeology again just because I'm interested in it. But so I didn't want to take the time to show you that, but that's an interesting artifact there. Well, Jehoshaphat, he's attacked. He's attacked by a coalition of Moabites and Ammonites, and he proclaims a fast. He brings all the people together. He seeks God for victory, for deliverance, and the Lord gave him that victory. So even though he had these alliances that, God rebukes him for and these kinds of things, he's a good king. You see, he's basically a good and faithful king. Well, Ahab's sons, he's got two sons. Ahaziah, was that second, Bill? First or second? First, okay. All right, I'll talk like this. All right, he's got two sons, Ahaziah and Joram/Jehoram. Ahaziah, he dies after only a two-year reign from injuries he received when he fell through the upper lattice in the palace. So he's like walking along and oops. So he goes through something and he sustains injuries. Now we're moving from 1 Kings into 2 Kings, just so you kind of know where we are. Okay, so this is right at the transition of into 2 Kings. So in that time, in his short time as a ruler, that's when he embarked on the ill-fated shipbuilding enterprise with Jehoshaphat. And that's no doubt what brought about Moab's rebellion. Okay, you have the death of his father, Ahab, and then we have, he gets injured. And then you can see a king who's just suffering under paying tribute. He says, okay, the time's good. And so that's what probably brings the revolt that then Joram/Jehoram goes and tries to put down. Joram, he comes to the throne after Ahaziah. And this is the king who enlisted Jehoshaphat's aid in trying to go to put down the revolt of Moab. And this is also the king to whom the king of Syria, you remember, he sent the commander Naaman to be healed of leprosy. So he says he's the king, and here comes the guy. He says, yeah, by the way, here's my commander. He's a good guy. I want you to heal him. And the king of Israel's going, what? Am I God? What's this guy? He's obviously trying to pick a fight with me. So he's really upset about it. But of course, the prophet Elisha, was the one who healed him. Of course, God healed him. But Elisha, he goes, go see the prophet. And he goes and sees the prophet. And you know that story. Well, later when the king of Syria, he sends a large army to seize Elisha to prevent him from revealing the king's military strategy to the king of Israel. He says, they know everything I'm doing. How's that? And they said, by the way, they got a prophet down there. How can they know everything I'm doing? He said, they got a guy, he's a prophet, and he's telling them. So he says, all right, well, I'm going to go get this guy. So he sends this army, a large force, down to capture Elisha for that reason. Now, this is when, you know, God, in response to Elisha's prayer, what does he do? He blinds the soldiers. So here they are. They got the drop on him. All of these people, just this one guy blinds the soldiers. And this, by the way, is when Elisha's servant was allowed to see the Lord's spiritual horses and chariots of fire all around him. That's when this occurred. And he comes out and he's going, oh, he's all afraid. And he says, show him. You see? This is reality. No, no, no. This is real. No, no, no. That's reality. So he let him see it. He lifted the veil and let him see. And so that was quite comforting. Well, Elisha leads these blinded soldiers into Samaria, into the capital of Israel. And then the Lord opened their eyes and Elisha ordered that they be treated well and sent home. So that's pretty, here they come. They're blinded. He says, okay, follow me. I'll take you where you need to go. Takes them right into the heart of Samaria. And then restores their sight. And how'd you like to be on that trip? And go, uh-oh. You see? He says, no. You treat them well. Feed them and send them home. And that's what was done. And still later, though, Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, he brings an even larger force and he besieges the city of Samaria. And this is when the people are starving. They're starving to death. And this is when you get the thing about, you know, how high food was and all that kind of thing. Well, but as prophesied by Elisha, God brought them sudden relief. He said, look, you know, tomorrow prices are going to drop. You're going to have all kinds of stuff. People are going, that can't happen. Even if God opened the windows then, that's never going to happen. He says, au contraire. Okay? So in keeping with what Elijah had prophesied, God brought sudden relief. The Syrian army was made to think that the Hittites and the Egyptians were coming to attack them. Well, how were they made to do that? Well, God made them think it. I mean, he said, what do we hear? We're Syrians. They're coming to attack us. We're trapped. Here we are trying to get them, and here they come. We better get out of here. So they flee. And they just take off and they leave everything. Well, how are you going to get that much food and supplies and everything so that you can have an effect on the starvation immediately? Well, the people who have it out there are going to leave it for you. And this is what they did. And this is when you had the lepers there who were thinking, they say, listen, we got a choice. We're starving to death here. We can die here or we can go give ourselves over to the Syrians. And maybe they'll spare us, maybe they won't, but either way, we're no worse off. So they go over, I heard that bell. They go over to the Syrians, and they're going to go over and turn themselves over, and they look around. Hello? You know, looking around, look. What's all this? Man, they look, all this. And then they go back and report, finally. They go back and report and say, you see, this is what's happened. Okay? I did hear that bell. So next week, Lord willing.